You probably remember the episode I did on easily transferring files around a home network or small business network. But what if you want to kick things up a notch and have a little more control, and you're ready to step up to the big leagues? Well, there's lots of hardware and software solutions out there. In fact, I've looked at some of them. I reviewed the Drobo with the Drobo Share previously. But I happen to think one of the best software solutions out there is the FreeNAS project. I'm going to take some existing hardware, load FreeNAS on top of it, and tell you about some unique ways you can leverage FreeNAS to get a kick-butt network storage system for free in this episode of An In-Depth Look. Probably most of you know what FreeNAS is, and probably a lot of you are even using it. For those of you who don't, FreeNAS is a super minimal, stripped-down version of FreeBSD that has a lot of flexibility and is kind of meant to run headless with no monitor or keyboard attached. It's just something you load on a device, and it runs on your network and can provide file access for your network and a lot of other services, which I'll cover in just a minute. Just some information about FreeNAS. It is based on FreeBSD version 6.4. So if you have a question, if FreeNAS supports this network card or does FreeNAS support this controller, all you have to simply do is go find out what FreeBSD version 6.4 supports, and then you'll know what FreeNAS supports. So that's kind of makes it easy to determine if your hardware is compatible with FreeNAS for whatever you're going to load it on. One of the kind of unique features is that it can run off of a compact flash or a CD-ROM. Now, why would you want that? Data. Protection. Drives can fail. Bad things can happen. This can help you prevent that. If you can run it off a solid-state compact flash, and it only takes an installed FreeNAS installation, just the base operating system, 32 megabytes. 32 megabytes. Yeah, I've got a 32 megabyte compact flash card around here somewhere I could load that on. And they've got a little compact flash, IDE to compact flash adapters. I'll link to those. And you can basically run a compact flash as if it was a hard drive in any system. It's very cool. And it means no moving parts, so small form factor or just less likely to fail. But if you're a little worried about maybe the life of your compact flash or something like that, you can also run it from a CD-ROM and then save the configuration to either a USB key or even a floppy disk if you still happen to have one of those. This gives you some options. You can actually build a pretty robust system that's fairly resilient from failure, at least for the operating system level, for cheap. I mean, usually to get that kind of protection, you'd have to have a mirrored drive system or a RAID 5 system that would cost you several hundred dollars. And in this case, they've come up with a system you can run off a 32 megabyte flash card or a CD-ROM. I mean, that's pretty nice. So FreeNAS has lots of services. So I'll go ahead and I'll start covering some of the key ones that I think are important and kind of discuss their features and how you set them up. Okay, so when you first start up in FreeNAS, it won't automatically have added any of the drives or external drives that are in your system. You have to go add them to a storage pool. That makes sense because you might have different pools of disks that you want to have assigned to different functions. So anything that it detects, you can add. You have to go up here to the disk menu and you have to go into a management area. The web interface to manage FreeNAS is very nice. Once you're in here, there's a couple of things that jump out. One thing you might notice is it does support doing iSCSI targets. Now, if you know what iSCSI is, that's really cool in a free product. If you don't know what iSCSI is, then it really won't matter to you because you're probably not in that necessarily level of remote network disk management, so it's not a big deal. All right, so I'm going to add my first drive to the system, and I can just simply click Add Disk. It already has the first disk that's not been allocated selected in a drop-down menu. Then you just simply have to title it. And then you can change the transfer mode, say if it's UDMA and things like that. But honestly, I don't know. I'm just going to leave it to auto. Now, this I really like. Some server systems always leave the disk spinning. Your drive will always be spinning. It will never go into power saver mode. Then other systems put them to sleep, and then when you go to connect to them, you have to wait for them to spin up and all those kinds of things. Well, this is really great because you can configure this, you can tweak this setting in FreeNAS. So you can say after 60 minutes of inactivity, go ahead and sleep. It's nice to have this feature exposed, and they even let you go down a little bit further and you can choose the spin speed if your drive happens to support that. So maybe if you have it in an office with you, you don't necessarily want it spinning at the absolute speed because it'll get kind of noisy. For me, I'm going to leave it to maximum performance, I don't care about the sound. The other reason you might want to adjust the sleep settings is sometimes if you're using a compact flash or SSD, it freaks things out to try to put it to sleep. So that's also another reason to be able to nice to just turn that off. I can also choose at this point to format. Now, FreeNAS is based off FreeBSD, so its file system of choice is going to be UFS. You also can put FAT32 or NTFS or EXT2 on there. I'm just going to say go ahead and do UFS. Or UFS with soft updates. And with soft updates means is it's essentially a journaling file system. So if the system were to lose power, you wouldn't lose the entire file system. You might just lose the writes that were in progress. So it handles failure a lot better. So now I'm going to say add. Once I add this drive, it's in there, and I can go share it out now. Now that we've got some drives added to our, well, one drive added to our FreeNAS, we need to enable a service. FreeNAS supports a ton of services. For just file services, it supports SMB. SMB is like, it's Windows file sharing. Every Linux box, every Mac box, every Windows box supports it. It supports FTP. Everybody knows what that is. It supports NFS. That's the network file. It's network file services for Unix and Linux. It supports Apple's file services. I mean, it supports everything. But we're going to just turn on SMB. Because like I said, it's kind of the default for Windows, and Mac and Linux also have great support for that. So not a problem right there at all. Now you can get kind of granular with your controls here, but I'm just going to simply turn it on. I'm going to leave it as a FreeNAS. Workgroup is fine. I don't really care. Authentication. I could get kind of specific here. For the purposes of the demo, I'm going to leave it anonymous. But you could set up user accounts. In fact, I recommend you do that. But I'm just going to leave it anonymous for now. And log level, I'm going to leave minimum. Depending on your system, be careful with this setting. You can actually generate a lot of load on a system by jacking that up. It might seem like a good idea at first, but I'd actually kind of recommend you leave it at minimum unless you're troubleshooting things. Local master browser, this is a great idea if you don't have a server on your LAN, but you have several networks. If you've noticed sometimes you've had problems resolving the names, well, this is probably because you don't have something on your network performing as the master name browser. FreeNAS will do that. It's set by default. Very nice. Here's where we can set some of our default settings, like the guest account information, what writes get set when you create files, and all those kinds of things. But the defaults are all great. If you know these settings, you can tweak them, obviously. But I recommend just leaving them at the default. Oh, this is really great. Enable extended attribute support. For a long time, this was really tough to do in Samba. If you check this box, if you go onto the FreeNAS server over the network, you can right-click on a file in Windows, and you can actually go to the security tab, and you can adjust the write settings in that security tab. Now, that might not seem like a big deal for you, but if you have some users on your network that aren't comfortable SSHing into your server and chmodding file writes, then checking this box saves you a ton of grief. This is huge if you're on a small business network, but it's also just helpful on your own LAN. I love that they've added that there. It's super, super great. So you're basically done with that. You hit save. If Samba was already started, it would restart the services and disconnect people, but since it hasn't even started yet, it's now online. And now I have a Samba server. Pretty awesome. In fact, it's already showing up on the network list over here in Nautilus. That's great. Aside from file services, there's also some very nice advanced network services that a FreeNAS box can provide. One of them, if you're like me and you download a lot of torrents for different distributions or other things, they have a built-in torrent server. What's that mean? Well, it's actually pretty slick. You go here to the BitTorrent section, and on here you can set up a live BitTorrent server that you can go to, upload a torrent file, and have it torrent for you in the background. You can shut down your main computers, and your network server will sit there and do the torrent for you and save it to a specified location. So I created a torrents share that I'm going to save all of my torrents into and that I can get to from my other computers once the download's complete. It uses a web interface to manage that, and it's actually really nice. It's an open source project called Transmission, and they have a web-based version. It looks a lot like a desktop application. You simply go there, you upload a torrent file, and it begins downloading it, and it'll seed it for a specified amount of time. And then when it's done, it's available in the share that you set up in the BitTorrent configuration page. That is really slick. Now, I'm pretty sure a fair majority of you, based on my stats, use iTunes. And sometimes it can be kind of a pain in the butt if you have a lot of music and you have multiple computers. FreeNAS has a solution for that. They have a built-in iTunes streaming server. You can set it up. It comes pre-installed. You point FreeNAS to your music, you go into the service, you set up a few settings, you click enable, and now you have a streaming iTunes server built into your FreeNAS box. You can upload music to the directory on your server through one of the shares. It'll automatically scan the directory, and then it'll be available on all the computers on your network that have iTunes. Or there's several open source music players that also support the DAAP music sharing protocol. I know Banshee is one of them, and I think Rhythmbox was another. And I think there's some plugins for a popular one called Armorock. A lot of you use that, I know. So I know a lot of the ones that people that watch these shows use are supported, so that's really awesome. Built-in iTunes streaming or just DAAP streaming right on your file server is very handy for centralized music, so you got to give them credit for that. And what's great about it is, again, it is dead simple to set up. That's a reoccurring theme here with FreeNAS, is a ton of power, but total simplicity in getting it going. I love that. So just a last couple of services I just want to mention really briefly that I thought were pretty nice that FreeNAS had. Kind of some things that put it over the edge for me as kind of the definite open source home storage and small business storage solution. For one, it's got a lot of great stats. You can get in here and get information about your system, your interfaces, and you can see right here my memory usage is 11% of 243 megabytes. It's a 256 megabyte virtual machine, but it read it as that. 11% of that's great. That means I've got lots of room. I do not have a lot of... This FreeNAS is not resource intensive, which means I've got cheap boxes I could load this on. I love it. Also, CPU usage is nothing. It's 0% right now. It fluctuates between 0 and 5%, but super, super low use. So that's one thing. Other things I really like, some of the other services... rsync. It has a built-in rsync server. That's going to make some backup options for me really great. I've been looking at different backup solutions. I'm going to do a video on that pretty soon. And rsync is built-in. Love it. Dynamic DNS. If I have a DNS address for my small business or my house, I can have it automatically update when my IP address change. Crazy cool. Awesome. Now, sure, there's other things out there to do that, but it's nice to have it all consolidated in one spot. I really love that. A few other things that are nice is it can also install third-party packages. So if you've people are producing packages for FreeNAS, and if you've downloaded them, you can simply browse to them, upload them up, and install them onto the server. Things like DNS servers and whatnot, pre-packaged online that you can download and load up. I think that's really nice because it gives you the flexibility and expansion. It also has some built-in troubleshooting information and, of course, logs if you need to review what's going on with your system, including the smart status of your hard drives, so you can determine if your hard drives are having some issues. One last service that I really am giddy about that I haven't played with yet is the Universal Plug-and-Play service. You might have heard this term before when thinking of Windows and things like that, but it's kind of a way to allow devices on the network to detect some multimedia devices. For example, the Xbox or the PlayStation 3 should, in theory, be able to detect my FreeNAS box, connect to them, see the media on those systems, and then be able to stream it from the FreeNAS to my Xbox 360 or PlayStation 3. That has some serious potential, and I've got to play with that, because if that can do that, that's huge. That is huge, huge, huge. Obviously, it also didn't work with the Popcorn Hour, which I have. I'm really excited to give the Universal Plug-and-Play server a try. It's got security things, too, that are really nice. For user control, it can tie in with LDAP or Active Directory. Again, I know I've said it 100 times, but on a small business, if you have an Active Directory server, you can point it at your Active Directory server's your Active Directory information, your server name, all those kinds of things. Give it an administrative account and password so it can attach to the domain, and then it'll start authenticating users against your AD database. Single point of authentication is huge in a business enterprise. FreeNAS supports that, or just a generic LDAP backend, which is also extremely handy. I gotta say, FreeNAS has got some killer features. I'm gonna play around with this for a little bit. I'll catch up with you guys in a minute. So that's my look at FreeNAS. I hope you found that information useful. I'm still kind of learning the whole FreeNAS system, but if you've got any questions, you can hit me up, twitter.com/ChrisLAS, ChrisLAS, and you can send me a question about FreeNAS, or you can email me, Chris@JupiterBroadcasting.com. I'll try my best to answer your questions, but since I'm still kind of learning it, I might not be able to answer them all. I'd like to also hear how you're using FreeNAS, because I know a lot of you out there use it. A lot of you have told me, Chris, check out FreeNAS. All right, I've finally done it. Now tell me, what are you using it for? What do you do with it? I want some ideas. I want to be inspired. So twitter.com/ChrisLAS is probably the best place to hit me up, or the email would also work. Oh, we also, of course, there's an ongoing form I've got to tell you about jupiterbroadcasting.com. If you're not going there and going to the forum, you're missing out. But also, if you've been to jupiterbroadcasting.com 100 times, do you know that we now have specific feeds for different versions of these videos that we put out? If you want to download these on the go or watch them on your computer later and have them through your RSS reader, we've got lots of feed options. You can find them over at jupiterbroadcasting.com. Oh, speaking of all of that, I've got to say, the number one question I get is, Chris, how do you guys do your shows? And it's either the audio shows that we do or you're asking about the video shows. I must get a dozen of those every episode we put out. Now, I really haven't been answering that question because I'm still kind of learning how to do all of this, specifically when it comes to the video editing. I'm really struggling with that. But I have all the hardware in place, and it's really actually quite a list. So head over to jupiterbroadcasting.com, and then up in the top bar, there is a our gear store, and I've put together a store of all of the different stuff that we use. You know, stuff from like a $1 headphone jack converter to a $800 HD camcorder. I don't know if it's that much, but you know what I mean. And if you are doing your own shows and you want to use any of that gear, if you buy it from there, it doesn't cost you anymore, but we make an Amazon commission off that. It just basically would help buy us a beer or something like that. It's not a lot of money, but it's, you know, it's nice. But if you're just kind of been curious about the different hardware and gear that we use, you can just go check it out for that reason. That might help you get you started down the path of the answer to how we make these shows, is go check that out, and it'll at least give you an idea of the hardware and equipment that we use. I've got the lighting, I've got the wiring, I've got the everything. Everything's on there. I spent some time putting that together, and it's pretty cool. That's over at jupiterbroadcasting.com, and like I said, there's our gear store. It's like a link, or just jupiterbroadcasting.com/store. So I'd love to hear if you have any kind of network storage solutions. Maybe it's not FreeNAS. Let me know. I think that'd be really cool. And I also want to remind everybody that I honestly could not do these shows, and I really appreciate it when you go over to GoDaddy.com and you use our code Linux to check out. I think it saves you about 20%, and it keeps these shows coming because that helps pay our bills, and that's really huge for us. So I really appreciate when everybody does that. Linux, when you check out at GoDaddy.com. All right, everybody, I think that just about wraps up this episode of An In-Depth Look. Please subscribe to our channel at youtube.com/JupiterBroadcasting so you can get these shows when they come out, and, you know, and I get to see we got more subscribers. I always like to see that. But really, it's getting to be a pretty active community over there, so it's not a bad time to jump in. All right, everybody, thanks so much for watching this episode of An In-Depth Look, and I'd love to hear from you. Keep it geeky.
This episode of An In-Depth Look was sponsored by GoDaddy.com. Starting at just $3.99 per month, Linux shared hosting from GoDaddy.com includes 99.9% uptime, 24/7 support, and free access to GoDaddy Hosting Connection, the place to install over 30 free applications sure to help you get the most from your hosting plan and website. Plus, as a viewer of An In-Depth Look, enter the code Linux, that's L-I-N-U-X, when you check out and save an additional 10% on any order. Some restrictions apply. See site for details. Get your piece of the internet at GoDaddy.com.